Another failure. Another relapse. Another episode. Another bipolar schizoaffective break. And the bees were back. And they were back like never before. The bees. Now, I had experienced many hospitalizations at this point. And there were about tens of thousands of bees, but this time, there were trillions and trillions of bees, and they were circling all through my body. I couldn't function. I needed some help. And I had been to other doctors, I had been to expensive doctors, my family had helped me, but I couldn't go back. I had to do this on my own. I had already been told that I wouldn't be able to function and I would have to live with my family for the rest of my life. But I couldn't do it anymore. So I went to the mental health public facility and I was on my hands and knees. And I said, please give me meds that will work. I just need some sanity. Give me meds that will work. You see, I wasn't that ambitious. I wasn't looking for happiness, right? I didn't have much motivation. I was going through hopelessness, but I had a burning desire to not feel powerless. A burning desire. Needless to say, they told me to go home. But to come back in 2 weeks and they would put me with a doctor. And I said, okay, so I got back home and I was by myself. What the heck am I gonna do for the next 2 weeks? What am I going to do when I cannot be by myself? So I did what I remembered from when I was a child. And I was raised believing in the power of prayer, which at that time was inconceivable, but it was all that I had. So I prayed, and it was a situation where I needed love, and so I got a little ambitious, and I said, God, I know that there is love out there. I have seen it before. The trees give us oxygen so we can breathe. Babies are born. Mothers are happy. The sun shines whether we're out here killing ourselves or not, unconditionally. The sun is shining. Can I be a part of that? Is there some sort of way you can fit me in? And in that moment, and I swear, I don't want to swear to God, but in that moment, I started to feel a little bit of easiness. And in that moment, it was like that deep, unfathomable pain was kind of easing itself a little bit. And I wasn't expecting that. I thought, you know, the blessing comes later, not now. So I started to pray all the time. I would be praying sometimes 3-4 hours a day because it was bringing me some sort of peace, and the bees were quieting down. And I never told you what the bees were, but those were my racing thoughts that I couldn't control. Those were the obsessive thoughts of whatever little thing, it could have been a minor thing that happened, and they would go round and round and round and round in my head, and drive me crazy. I couldn't read a book, I couldn't watch a TV, and I thought the TVs were talking to me. And I said, God, why did you do this? Why do I have a brain that does this? And again, I was getting, in that intensity, I was getting some relief. I was asking for answers. My appointment came, and I was put with this short, petite, Persian lady with the most beautiful, thick accent. And her name was Dr. Bark. And she asked me so many questions. I'm telling you, I mean, I had been to doctors in Brentwood. No, I mean, I'm serious. I had had that family support. But they never asked me as many questions as she had asked me. And then I wasn't really taking my medicine as well. And she said, Yashi, I can't help you unless you take your meds, then we can see what's working and not working. Otherwise, I don't know how to put you on the right things. So if you don't take it every day, we don't know what we're doing here. And that made perfect sense. I'm like, okay, that does make sense. You know, in the past I was like, medication, really? But when she said that, I was like, all right. And with that, we got it right. And from then on, I felt better in 8 weeks than I had in 8 to 10 years, just by being put on the right medicines. They help the delusions, they help the hopelessness, and they say you will know you're on the right meds when you don't feel like you're on meds. Okay? When you don't feel like you're on medication, is when you get it right. Now, I'm not saying it's for everybody. I do believe there's all sorts of roads to trying to find that balance into what I call living in the journey of recovery. It's a journey. But in my case, I had pretty severe symptoms, okay? And they needed to be harnessed. I say all of this now because I didn't have anybody that I could watch, or there was no one to kind of allow me that I saw out there that had been through the severity of the symptoms that were actually doing well and going on with their life and finishing college and doing all these amazing things, except that they had the minor symptoms. Okay, the minor ones, but they still had, you know, the ones where you kind of hypomanic, but you don't really, you know, you can still kind of function. Those individuals were talking, but the folks with my situation and my labels, they weren't talking if they were doing well. So I said, when I got better, I said, I'm gonna make a commitment and I'm gonna talk about this. And I'm gonna open up and I'm gonna be as raw and I'd be as actual and I'm gonna be as frank as I can be because I know it's gonna save somebody's life. You guys, own your story. Own it. That's what we got. How do we expect to get rid of stigma if we're stigmatizing ourselves? How do we expect to, I mean, seriously, if we're having self-imposed stigma, how are we going to affect the stigma out there? And with that, I'd like to say NABI was the first organization that accepted me in. I went to NABI because that was the organization that talked about families. And that's what makes NABI special. And I became an ambassador for NABI. I just want to say, I recognize and I work with so many amazing movements, amazing organizations, but no, NABI will always be the one. That was the first one. So with that said, I'm a little close on time, but I am going to do a spoken word performance right now. My mind has a mind of its own, and it won't leave well enough alone. And my brain can't control itself. Yashi, you are amazing, brilliant, genius, psycho, stupid, loser, scatterbrain, get it together. So you don't hear all of this, but I do, so I need you to help me and be patient. Please, don't go. See, I write poetry. I write because my throbbing heart demands me. I write because it's extreme. I was born passionate, loud, deep, afraid, I guess, sometimes. I was born. Damnation! Who created this hot springs without upselling salvation? Extreme as unnatural, except in the mansion of mental illness. But unless there's extreme, I simply don't feel me. No, I don't think you heard me, those people who don't understand this. I just don't feel me. Look at me. You would never know right now that I've been courted away for acts so deranged. And will somebody please tell me what are imbalanced chemicals anyway? I am severely severe in all clinical severities, though severely thick psychiatric books with new severe terms every day, and I wouldn't know them if they all ran up and severely slapped me in the face. They're like unidentified flying objects. We've all heard they exist. Most don't believe it, only some see it. Those who live to treat it don't have the money to beat it, but those who entertain, what a gold mine. Best actor, best actress, best song. Watch this reenactment once we finish editing the insane. Now you walk outside on Skid Row when you leave this place. There are no accolades. There are no Golden Globes. There are no Oscars. And there are no Grammys. But hearts popping up and down, basketballs beating down the streets. And in New York, the 1-2-3 trains, the stench and the gibberish, they say, you're hurting my frequency. You're hurting my frequency. I have no comeback. I have no comeback for these street and metro clowns. Goodness gracious, get it together. See, I see me before my recovery. The CEO sees his son that can't kick coke and methamphetamines. I assure you, mental illness does not discriminate. We all know we see something. But God, I have worked on myself and I have done my time to rise. Why must you show me this and splash cold water on me? And then I look to the side, my body constricts. Walk past me, walk past me. But if I was so aware and divine, why is he looking me in the eye and say, God bless you at the pocket change I just denied? And if I was so divine and I was so aware, why didn't I see the power laying dormant within him instead of connecting with the funk that fills my eyelids and nostrils? See, we have it within us to see the universe and to see something beautiful in each other, no matter what we look like. You know why? We do this every day, usually, with our own children. No matter what we see, no matter what they do, we still see the best in them and significant loved ones. See, when I was released from UCLA, I looked for the one who conceived. I looked for the one who could treat my extreme, the ones who believe, the ones who support, those of my blood, and it was yours, nonprofits, groups, associations, and connections. I looked for one who could look me in the eye and see me in a state most high. Love. Yes. Love. Again, once we get past all the pretenses and we realize we are just much more than five senses, we'll be able to see and we'll be able to understand that we are all a royal reflection. And royal it truly is once we can lovingly channel, rechannel what was formerly known as mental illness. Thank you.